champagne, but it's very similar to champagne.
Very similar to champagne. It's Lambrusco. No. Champlain was an important French territorial military governor in the early 1600s. Okay, remember, when I say 1600s, we're talking 17th century, right? Actually, all of that stuff is arbitrary. It just helps us know how far back we have to think. So, in the early 1600s, Champlain and other French explorers were trying to extract whatever value they could get out of the New World, out of New France. And what they discovered right away was there was excellent timber, and the timber was not taken back for firewood or logs. The timber was utilized for a very important resource, which was masting beams and ships. Okay. We had really tall pines, firs, hemlocks, spruce, cedars, things like that, that made excellent masts. They didn't use fiberglass. So all that stuff was of great value. But they also discovered that just like in parts of Europe, particularly Eastern Europe, and the mountainous regions, there were lots of resources in furs. Now, furs weren't just utilized for the fur pelt itself. Furs were also used as trim, as muffs for hands, as things around hoods and collars to keep warm, as lining in slippers, but also, even more importantly, furs of the right kind were shaved and treated and utilized as pressed felt. How many of you guys have seen felt? It just was Christmas. There, you see a lot of felt in some stuff. Usually the crap that you hang on fireplaces and stockings is about half felt. Okay? Felt is really, nowadays, mostly made from rabbit fur. They're raising little farms. Somebody eats them, somebody uses the fur. Well, they get the rabbit fur all gooey with the material and they get it hot and they press it and then they felt. And it's pretty neat stuff. It's fairly pliable. It doesn't fall apart easily, but it will stretch, and like I said, it's pliable, so it'll sag. But felt made from beaver fur can be made almost as stiff as a board. Certainly, really quite firm, and can be shaped into any kind of hat, or collar material, or trim that you want. And so, hats, which in those days without a whole lot of central heating, everybody had. Men, women, kids, everybody had hats. So the beaver was important not just for fur, but also for the whole hat industry, for felt. And they realized that there were plenty of them in New France. And so one of the things they immediately did was to try to make friends with the indigenous, with the First Nations that were already there. And so beginning in the early 1600s, they met the Mi'kmaq in Maine and Abenaki along the Lawrence River. And when they got as far as the head of this huge lake in New Hampshire, New York, called Lake Champlain nowadays, they met the Iroquois, and across the river in what's now Canada, the beginning of the various Algonquin groups, and just a little bit further to the west, closer to the Great Lakes, were the Hurons. Now, can you remember who the characters in Black Robe were tribally?
Iroquois, Huron.
Who were they going to find ultimately in the end? The Huron, right? So he was leaving from here and going all the way to here. It was a canoe trip. By the time he got to the Huron, what did he find? Not chicken pox, smallpox, right? So even though they made the journey early, he thought he might be among the first unless he saw that Father so-and-so who supposedly had been there previously to see him. But already the disease, particularly when everybody has to huddle together in the winter and they're beginning to trade with whites, spreads rapidly. So that did show you some of the things that we're going to have to consider when we talk about the development of the North throughout history. Is white trade, white European culture mingling with native culture, and the native cultures living together in various loosely claimed, unorganized homelands. So in fact, most of those culturally, tribally distinct groups live similarly to how you might describe packs of wolves. Communally, cooperatively, they worked together, they defended a certain area where they got everything they needed, but at some point, if they went far enough out of where they normally hung out, what would they run into? Other wolves, right? Another pack doing the same thing, defending an area. So that border between what was considered homelands was always a little bit uneasy. It was not firm, this is the point. There was no line drawn on maps. It was sort of like, how far this way can we go, and how far this way do they come? If we don't want them to get from here to here, we have to stop them or push them back. So that kind of border conflict over resources, very similar to wolf packs, occurred all over the Americas in these groups. Sometimes it was handy. There was a huge thing like a Great Lake between one group and another. Didn't really then have a lot of conflict over land. But they might meet out on the lake. In which case, they could be buddies, they could trade, or they could argue, right? All right, so what we've got now is the Mi'kmaq, the Abenaki, the Iroquois, the Algonquin, and the Huron, and that gets us all the way to the beginning of the Great Lakes. What the French, at about this time and shortly thereafter, discovered is that at that point, you could virtually go by water all the way to here on the northwestern shore of Lake Superior. And there, they learned from the Ojibwa that if you portaged just about 9 miles, you got into a series of lakes in a watershed that went fairly continuously with small portages all the way to the Great Lake of the Woods. That area I'm talking about right now is where Boundary Waters lie. It was on the first major land highway west and north of the Great Lakes. And of course, the highway itself wasn't really the land, it was the water. So the French began to, you know, explore over there. And in order to survive, they had to figure out how to avoid some of the conflict that you saw in Black Road, which was conflict between one tribe and another, and conflict between themselves and the tribe. I'll say tribe, that's not really the correct word, it should always be nation, because they identified themselves as one and together. So anyway, what the French did, by and large, was try to ingratiate themselves with this First Nation that they ran into. Often that meant giving them things, things that they really wanted to have. Sometimes it meant intermarrying. Pick some important family or family with some desire to improve their status or make life easier. French man, because they practically only had men here on this continent at that time, would try to intermarry or couple with a native First Nation woman. That automatically bound him to that group. They knew they were going to get some of these goodies that white people had because of that connection, and he knew that they would help him go out and extract the things he wanted, specifically furs. Okay, in the old days, the Ojibwa, in the eastern part of what is later to become the Boundary Waters, controlled that whole access from Lake Superior towards the west. So the first fort that was built at right near Grand Portage, which is yet still right on the border, but in Minnesota, right there. It's at the beginning of the big portage, the 9-mile portage to take that Voyager's route. And the Ojibwa were there, and by this time they had already begun to be called by an improper term. Their name for themselves is Ojibwa. Ojibwa. And it later, over time, became slurred into Chippewa. That really was not their name for themselves, but that's what we call it. So they said, okay, who are the people to the south and the west of here? And they named the Cree, the Salto, and the Dakota. But they didn't call them by the name they called themselves. They called them by the names that they had for what those people represented to them in their livelihood. So the Ojibwa told the French that these people south of them, towards where the great Mississippi was, and west of them, in the general direction heading into Lake Winnipeg and so forth, that they were Nedewesiu, as a long term of several words, Nedewesiu, which means the snake-like enemies. Over time, the French just referred to them as Sioux, okay? But that never was the name for themselves. Their name for themselves is Dakota. And that means the allies. So now you've got two major groups in the general area, which later would become the Boundary Waters. One dominant on the Great Lakes side and to the north, and another one on the west side and to the south. By now, when the French are there, it's really only the middle of the 1600s. So for several decades, they're plying their trade across the Grand Portage up into Lake of the Woods. From Lake of the Woods, this is not real clear to see, but if you had a U.S. map, you could tell. From Lake of the Woods up to Lake Winnipeg, from Lake Winnipeg, you can either go to Hudson Bay, which means for part of the year you can go out into the Atlantic Ocean through the Arctic. Or you can go to Lake Athabasca and Great Slave Lake and clear up to the Yukon and the Arctic to the northwest. So they knew that by now. Hudson, who was English, had sailed into this southern bay of the Arctic Ocean, and knew that it was getting awfully close to being able to cut off the French here. The French, on the other hand, sent people off to Mississippi. They sent Marquette and Joliet up the Mississippi. They went as far as Minnesota. And there are towns along the Mississippi with their names. Nicollet also came up into Minnesota, at least as far as the Falls of St. Anthony. And you need to know where that is geographically, because the Falls of St. Anthony is actually just not that far above St. Paul and Minneapolis on the Mississippi. But it was essentially the end of what a large boat could do, because it was a pretty big falls. And so it was only navigable above that if you portaged your boat or if you used canoes. So from Minneapolis north, it was still wilderness, even when the French were exploring. But they built some trading posts, and they realized if they continued north from that area, they could get to the Great Lakes, which is what they had already been getting to from the east. Not only could they get to the Great Lakes, but they could actually get to the Boundary Waters Trail that they've been on, the Voyager's Trail, and still get up to the northwest. And in 1730s, this is just significant because this is the connection between the Mississippi drainage and the Great Plains and the Missouri drainage. In the 1730s, French explorers, two brothers, I never know for sure how to spell this, but I'm going to give it a try. Berengray brothers. They were French. They were at Lake Winnipeg, and they heard that if you crossed a plain and got to a big river shed, you could eventually go down two rivers that would end up in the Missouri River, which was the major river that went to the big water. They learned that, not from Europeans, but from what other French voyagers had previously heard from natives they had talked to. So they had an idea that there was this Mississippi, and there was this Missouri, and there was Lake Superior, and there was this route, Lake Winnipeg, and you could get to other rivers that would take you to the Missouri. So now they knew you can get up into this great northwest by the Great Lakes, you can get to it by the Mississippi, which the mouth of which is near New Orleans, and you can also get to it by the Missouri. So let's say this is like the 1620s. By this time, in the 1650s, they'd begun doing this back and forth, exploring up this way at the same time in the late 1600s. And by 1730, they had gone up here, cut across the prairie to the Missouri and North Dakota. Now they knew they could access all this Northwest territory from three different directions. Not too long after that, though, in the 1750s, there was a war. Anybody know what that war was called? It was the Revolution. Was it the Civil War? No, in the 1750s, because England already had Hudson there. England already had their eye on everything north of their colonies in New York. They had allied with the Iroquois. And they were not favorably inclined towards France. And France already had their eye on all this Great Lakes territory, upper New York, and had allied with the Huron and some Algonquin, who were enemies of the Iroquois. So this war then that began, was referred to as the French and Indian War. Alright? But it wasn't French and Indians who went to war. The reason we call it this is because our heritage stems from everything that happened south of Canada, which was dominated by England. So it was England describing who they were fighting. They were fighting the French and these Indians. The French were fighting the English and these Indians. Both France and England used the Indians to do a whole lot of the fighting. Tried to clear out settlers, tried to clear out army platoons, brigades, all kinds of stuff, tried to dam rivers so that naval ships couldn't get up into Lake Champlain and the Great Lakes. It went on for several years. Ultimately, though, England captured several big garrisons in Montreal and other places east of the Great Lakes, Ottawa, places like that. And France decided, you know, it's not really worth carrying on this huge war. And they signed a treaty. Ended the French and Indian War. So what happened to all this land here in New France? It became England, Northern Canada, just like they did in the U.S. But who was already out there married to all the Ojibwa and other natives, and who was already out there who knew all the routes and had been running the Voyager's Trail for decades, a century almost, by then? It was the French, right? So even though Hudson Bay Company, which was the name of the fur company, owned by England, now controlled all this, who did they have to hire for their employees and factories in various posts and at the various tribal locations? Who?
French,
right? So meanwhile, they have the French working for them under the supposed control of the English factor at the fort and the army and so on. But the Frenchmen already had a lot of stuff figured out about how to sort of not cooperate, be passive aggressive. So they had learned already how to get furs down all the way to New Orleans this way and this way. And they kept doing it, just funneling things off to this guy. And also, at the same time, running a business and collecting their portion of wages and royalty and whatever, and sending stuff back to you. So they were kind of doing a double duty. Now, I want to go back to the Barren Grays over here, because when they hit the Missouri River in North Dakota, they came down and met a group of natives called the Mandan, spent some time with them, got horses from them in the 1730s, and took a trip up and around the Black Hills. Here's the Bighorns, B-H-M, Bighorn Mountains, that's Wyoming, Montana, and the Black Hills, which is Wyoming, South Dakota, back on the Cheyenne River, to the Missouri, back to the Mandans, and back here. So they'd already been to the Rockies by the 1730s. They'd already been on the upper Missouri. They'd already been with the Mandan. And that was almost 70 years before Lewis and Clark. And we think of them as the first Anglo. But in fact, who did Lewis and Clark pick up at the Mandan village in winter of 1805, they picked up two people. Who were they? Do you know? One of them was a female, What's her name? Anybody know that?
Sacagawea.
Yeah, Sacagawea. She was Shoshone. But she had been captured as a young girl at the Three Forks of the Upper Missouri, sold, traded, and then married to a Frenchman named Charbonneau. Charbonneau and other Frenchmen had been living off and on with the Mandan ever since the 1730s. So there were plenty of contacts between Europeans and the natives in that area decades and decades prior to Lewis and Clark. It's already a pretty well-known place. So it wasn't until you actually got west of there on the Missouri to the Great Falls, which just like the one at St. Anthony here in Minnesota, this one right here in Montana was the end of major transportation by boat on the Missouri. Then you were off the map. Then you
what
were
city is that here?
That's pretty near Great Falls. And it's called Great Falls because it's just upriver from Port Burford, which is where the BLM starts the canoe trips that you do on the scenic portion of the Wilson Park canoe trip. So the French knew everything about from here to there. They knew everything from here to there and then figured out how to connect. They figured out how to connect all this with that. And they've been extracting things out of there for a long time. Now, what's going on? Remember what I said? One of the motivations the First Nations had for allowing the French to be there and to provide furs for them was the stuff they had, right? Well, how did the natives get the furs they wanted to trade for this stuff? Okay, there were several ways. I'm going to answer these questions, but it's going to take a long time. They particularly realized that if they went out in the winter, the pups were no longer as small, so it was a good time to get them. And the beavers were in their houses because the ice was frozen. So the only place they went up to get air was back into the house. They'd go out under the frozen ice, get sticks and bark they'd hidden down there, bring them up into the thing, chew on them, say, how you doing, you know, to each other, lie around, get warm, and go back out, take the old sticks out and let them go, bring in some new ones. The natives learned you could just tear the lodge apart and get them all. Or you can, in places where there's a little bit of open water, they may still come up out of the water and cut a birch tree, or cut a willow tree, or cut a olive. And if they do that, it is possible to set up a trigger and a deadfall to have them caught by a falling log, which may have been on top of them. Stuff like that. Or they might see one swimming and try to shoot it with an arrow. But what's an easier way to get them at any time of the year? A trap. And the traps were made out of metal and provided to the First Nations to get beavers with anytime, any place, any time of the year. Okay. Pretty much just like this. This is much newer than the period we're talking about, but it's the same design, basically. Okay, so when you set this in the water, in a place you can see it coming up and down, just underwater, this long chain then is hooked to like maybe a 20-foot